Jacob. In times past, when I've had an opportunity to worship with you and preach, I've moved right on into the preaching, foregoing any introductions and whatnot, because I believe that it's important that you just get right into what you've been called to do. That's what we've all been waiting for. But I'm going to take a little bit of a diversion this morning just to say a little something after being at this church for some 13 years and turning 50 on Monday. I have literally become who I am on today, quite frankly, during my time here at Bethlehem Baptist Church. I came here some 13 years ago, I dare say, a mess. Not so bad, but bad enough that I didn't know who I was, didn't know what the Lord wanted me to do or who he wanted me to be. I was floundering between changing jobs each year and a half or so. I was a okay husband and a fairly good father, but I wasn't fully who I wanted to be. And I dare say that since I've been here, there have been people at the Bethlehem Baptist Church who have looked around and seen more potential in myself than I actually saw in myself. Starting with Pastor Kwan, who has pushed me to be more than I ever could imagine. And then secondly, beginning with Lady Kwan, who pushed me into this place of being a worship leader. She said, one day I just happened to step in and be the worship leader at the old church at 7:30 in the morning, and she was there, Pastor wasn't there, and for some reason, done a fairly good job, and she said to Pastor Charles, have you seen this young man named Keith Hodges lead worship before? He said, no. She said, you should let him lead worship at 7:30. He made a point to be there the next Sunday, and I've been there ever since. And then someone looked about the congregation. That's not the end of the story. Somebody looked about the congregation and said, that young man there probably could stand to serve and be on our diaconate board. And was asked to do that. Couldn't quite understand why somebody would ask me to be a deacon in some kind of leadership, the mess that I was. But one thing that happens when people are looking to see more in you than you are, sometimes you just need to step up and give it a try. And so you can see what it is that they're talking about. I did that. A year later, I served as a co-chair on the diaconate board. I led the diaconate board. And then I took a trip to Kenya, Africa, along with Pastor and an initial group to go see the orphanage that we had adopted in Kenya. And on that trip there, coming down what's called the Ogada Road, everyone else was asleep in this van. And my mother had just recently passed, and I began to hear this alliteration of her voice, just audibly saying that, I'm with you, Keith, I'm with you. And I began to cry, and I began to clench my fist, and I'm sharing with you all this. I heard a voice say that I'm calling you. And I dare say that that was the voice of God saying, I'm calling you more and deeper to where it is that you are right now. Not so much being called to pastor, not being so much to lead an institution, but I'm calling you deeper. Soon after that, I enrolled in seminary, and some 6 years later, I'll be graduating as Pastor mentioned on May the 23rd. There have been things that have been happening to me and for me at the Bethlehem Baptist Church that I could never imagine. I'm only sharing that with somebody that you might use that as your own testimony in your own life to declare that things will begin to move at light speed in your life when you simply say yes. Let's pray. God, I thank you from the depths of my soul for allowing me to develop and to grow into the servant that you called. I pray now in the name of Jesus that you would use me. Show me how to take all that I have sat with this week and sat under and use it for a purpose greater than myself. In Jesus' name, amen. The scripture was read this morning. And if you stand to your feet and turn to the book of 1 John, go past your Gospels to the epistle or the letter from John. It's 1 John, the fourth chapter, and simply the 20th verse. 1 John 4:20. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. If someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister, that person is a liar. For if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? The word of the Lord. This is the last Sunday in Black History Month. And I want to embrace that as I begin to worship with you around the subject, forgiving the pain. I need you to take a moment right now, and I'm not talking about a physical pain either. I'm talking about something that you may have done in your past, something that you may be dealing with right now, something that you can foresee that is coming, that is an emotional pain for you. We're going to unpack that in a little bit, but I need you to take a moment and think on some things you may have done, some places you may have been, some experiences that you may have shared and that represent for you in your living as pain. And I need you to say to yourself, I forgive myself. Mm-hmm. Say that right now, I forgive myself. A couple months ago, I had a wonderful opportunity to get down to the Smithsonian Institution's African American Museum of History and Culture. If you have not had an opportunity to share in that experience, you must. It is a mandatory, watch this, American experience. Did y'all catch that? Yeah, it's more than an African-American experience. It is an has anyone had a chance to share in that? Yeah, it is an American experience. When you arrive at the building itself, it is as the Smithsonian Institution represents in Washington, D.C., probably to me one of the most astounding edifices that are built, that is built in D.C. It represents, for those of you who may not have caught that story, but it represents a Yoruba crown. That is one of our tribes of Africa, and it's the crown that would rest on the head of one of our queens. It rises up like the palms of your hand. If I start like this and I start at its base, it rises up just like this, and it almost stretches itself out to the heavens and to God. And it's built of these beautiful bronze plates. As you arrive at the institution, they herd you onto a glass-encased elevator where you should begin your tour. You can do anything that you want, but I'm encouraging this. They herd you on at about 100 at a time, and they slowly close the doors behind you. As you're standing there, you can look at the walls around you and begin to see that there are dates that have been inscribed onto the cement, beginning with 2016, which is the year that the building itself was erected. And then slowly, brothers and sisters, it begins to descend in what I refer to as the catacombs of the building, because I dare say that it descends some three or four levels or tiers below street level. And as you go down, you can move 360 degrees around and begin to see the dates are beginning to transcend down as well. So I don't recall them exactly, but I believe the next date may have been 2008, representing and celebrating the election of the first African-American president to these United States, Barack Obama. And then it continues to descend, capturing other significant dates within our African culture. And then it slowly comes to a rest. And the date that you'll see is the year 1619. And for those of you who are historian buffs, will recall that as the date of the beginning of the transatlantic slave trade, where the ships who literally stole Africans from the west coast of Africa landed in Jamestown, Virginia. Does anybody remember their history? Yeah, and so that began some 400 years of slavery that existed here in these United States, these so-called United States. And I need you to understand something. My wife and I spent some 3 hours down there in that slavery exhibit, just exploring it, listening to the testimonies of slaves that had been brought here against their will, watching how babies were snatched out of the arms of mothers as they were sold on the auction block from one plantation to the next, listening as young men were lynched or beaten and just dehumanized and broken down and taken further away from a systematic way of tearing a culture apart, tearing a people apart, making them to believe that this existence in which they established themselves was actually culturally right, and that they deserved it, and it was a place where they should be, watch this, according to God's word. And I need you to know something. If you stay right there on that level, and you do not begin to escalate upstairs and see what has happened to African people after that enslavement, then you'll be left bitter and angry, and you may leave that place ready to hurt somebody. And so you've got to go upstairs to the first floor so that you can see what we've done in science. You've got to go up to the second floor so you can witness what we've done with the arts. You've got to go up to the third floor and see what we've done with our nonprofit work and our dance and our music and our automobiles and everything that we've done by way of our own blood, sweat, and tears to add to the melting pot and the history of this nation. And yet, what you're left with as you leave the place is that there was this crying out based on the pain that we had to suffer. There was a crying out based on the dehumanization, based on the lack of understanding, based on the unbelief of how something like this could happen to another human being. And yet, somehow, some way, even despite all of that, we as a people, African people, continue to persist, continue to be loving, continue to be kind, continue to be open, continue to embrace. I know that our word teaches us that the Jewish people are the anointed and the chosen people, but for my own mental stability and upkeep, I've got to believe that the African people are an anointed people as well. And what has happened is that if you look in the book of Exodus, in the third chapter, at the 23rd verse, there's something that reflects what's happened to a people. It says, years passed, and the king of Egypt died. But the Israelites continued to groan under their burden of slavery. They cried out for help, and their cry rose up to God. God heard their groaning. And he remembered his covenant promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He looked down on the people of Israel and Africa and knew it was time to act. And so he sent them a Moses who delivered them. And coming out of slavery, we were sent someone because God heard our cry. And so he wasn't perfect, neither was Moses. But God sent us Abraham Lincoln to emancipate the slaves. And if you fast forward, you can understand that even despite that emancipation, slavery continued to exist. There's something during Reconstruction called the Black Codes. And Pastor mentioned something called 13. There's a movie that if you haven't seen, you need to join us at the synagogue so you can see that. Just because slavery by legislation was emancipated and written by statute no longer exists, there was still that systematic dehumanization that looked to keep folk down. And so there's something called the Black Codes. You all remember your history for a second. And then after the Black Codes, this was simply a thing that said, okay, there'll be no gathering of black folk. We didn't have any jobs. There was no place to employ us. And so all we could do was sort of be idle, and they outlawed that. And then there's something called Jim Crow that kicked in. That's now we're kind of trying to come in more contemporarily. Then there was something called Jim Crow that kicked in. That was segregation and a keeping down and a separation of blacks and whites. You drink on this fountain. You enter this way. You ride at the back of the bus. And then out of Jim Crow came the Ku Klux Klan, who were anointed, according to them, by God to pursue their place of hate and degradation. And there was another cry out because of the pain. And so God lifted somebody else up. And there were the Fannie Lou Hamers of this world. There were the Dr. Martin Luther Kings of this world. Before I get into the text, we're just walking back in history. We have a little history lesson. And we were given the right to vote based on our cry out to pain. And we were considered to be human. And we were considered to be people. And we could marry someone who was white. We could marry someone who didn't look like us. I'm trying to help somebody just remember. When you have been in the midst of your own pain, have you ever had to cry out in the middle of the night and say, oh God, just help me?
Yes.
And did he move? Did he act? Did he send somebody? Did he lift somebody up out of nowhere to help you in your situation? Just when you thought you couldn't make it anymore, just when you thought that situation at your job, that person in your life, that thing that was causing you to cry out in the middle of the night, just when you thought there was no more that you could bear, God sent someone into your life to part the Red Sea and to deliver you out of your situation. Is there anybody who can testify? And Psalm 121 puts it like this: I look to the hills from which cometh my help. Charles Wesley puts it like this: Father, I stretch my hands out to thee. No other help I know. And that leads us into our text. I appreciate you walking with me there for a moment. Our text is in the book 1 John. It is, as I mentioned before, an epistle or a letter of the gospel writer. John does this with his gospel writing, which tells the story of Jesus Christ, but then he does something else with his letter or his epistle. John's gospel explains how Jesus Christ came to offer eternal life. His letter tells how to know by experience and behavior that we have eternal life. John's gospel tells us how Jesus came to reveal the Father. His letter shows how we can be confident in our relationship with the Father. The gospel relates how Jesus gives the Spirit to each one of us who is born again. The letter explains daily life while that Spirit is in you. The gospel encourages those of us who call us his disciples to practice spiritual unity by loving one another.
Amen.
And his letter clarifies how to do that or to put it into action. So you see, there is this separation between John's gospel and John's letter. As a matter of fact, just to show you the separation from a space point of view, if you've ever been in one of our liturgical churches, and what I mean by that is an Episcopalian church or you Roman Catholics, it's not built like the Baptist church. There are actually two separate places from which things are preached from or either things are said from. If you're sitting in the congregation and you're facing the pulpit, and on the right is the gospel side. Am I right for you, Episcopalians? Yeah. And on the left side is the epistle side. Never is the word of God preached from the epistle side. It's always preached from the gospel side, because that's the good news of Jesus Christ. And you don't mix that with anything else. You hear what I'm saying? Don't you mix the good news of Jesus Christ with anything else. God has come so that you would understand. And I like the way my friend Jerome Coleman put it. He put it like this: God has come not so much to fulfill for you your every need, but God sent his only son to supply all of your needs. Let me say that one more time. See, you sitting at home in pain, believing that if you lift it up to God, that by miracle, by some miraculous divine movement of God, he's going to come right to you in your home and all of your pain and all of your despair, and he's going to somehow, some way provide for you all of your need. That's not how it works. The thing you need, the distinction that is made, is that God has come to supply all of your needs. Okay, let me make it plain for you. So you hungry, right? Yeah. You can be hungry and do nothing if you want to, but what you better do is go to the refrigerator, get some wheat bread, get some cheese, get some turkey, get some mayonnaise, get some mustard, and a pickle, and feed your hunger. Yeah, are you with? Yeah, God just ain't gonna miraculously do something with your flat belly that's up against your back. He's gonna supply you with what you need. Okay, let me tell you about that car you got out there in the parking lot. You can let it sit there with no gas in it if you want to, believing that the Lord's going to be able to crank it up anyway. No, you've got to take some money out of your wallet, go to the gas station, and fill. He will supply all of your needs. Yeah, see, when you need some intimacy, okay, I'm not going to go down that path. Yeah, let me go down that path. So, we all need somebody. We need to be loved. My wife, I saw her at 17, and I said, I will see you in Atlanta. I was going to Morehouse, she was going to Spelman. And I saw her, and I said, I'm going to marry her. And it took me a little bit to get it together, but I got it together, and we still together. But God knows that I needed somebody. God knew that she needed somebody. And so you can sit at your home if you want to and not understand that there's somebody out there for you. You got to get on out and go explore. You got to get on out and date. You got to get on out and see. God will supply for you all of your needs. And so that's what John does in this letter as we move into our text. He gives us so much information, and it's a short book. It's an easy read. Move through it. And then we move to this fourth chapter, this 20th verse. This is the first thing that we see. The text says, if someone says, I'm going to stop right there. If someone says, claiming it tells me who you are. So, in this administration right now, my brother Eric puts it like this: your lips are moving, but you ain't saying nothing. Have y'all heard that before? Yeah. There are lots of claims being made. There are lots of assertions being made. There are lots of alternative facts being delivered. There's lots of things being said, but a claim is something where you have actually had an opportunity to think about what you're saying. To understand that you've researched what you're saying, that it's an actual fact, and that it has been proven. That's what Christ does for me and for you. Christ says, ask it in the name of Jesus, and I will do it so that I can give the Father glory. Do y'all understand why when somebody's praying, they'll come to a pause and somebody in the congregation will yell out, in the name of Jesus? Because they've just said something and they ask it in the name of Jesus because they know that I've just asked if my back pain can be healed, if you'll move me through this battle with cancer that I have, if you'll help me understand that the trials and tribulations that I'm suffering at work, if you help me to understand that my relationship is in trouble, if you help me to understand that things are getting a little bare at home and I need some help, if you ask it in the name of Jesus, Jesus will do it so that he can give the Father glory. It ain't got nothing to do with you. It's got to do with Jesus saying, I'm claiming. I'm saying what I'm going to do. I'm going to give my Father glory. So if you ask me, I'm going to do it. And Christ doesn't do anything that he doesn't say or believe or prove to us. Am I right about it? If you have ever been in a situation and you have said, Jesus, I need your help, and he has done it, that is your testimony. I need somebody in here who's just a little bit older who might be able to help these young folk in here understand that when you ask it in the name of Jesus, it may not happen immediately, but Jesus is going to show up at the right time. And when he shows up, he will turn your situation around. He will make it for the better. You can try anything you want to try, but you better ask it in the name of Jesus. And try being in pain. Pain is a distressing feeling often caused by intense or damaging stimuli. At the funeral home, they buzzed me the other day and said, Keith, we got a leak in the ceiling. Just got the chapel redid, and here I got a leak in the ceiling. That's all right. Things happen. We're going to do them. I'm asking it in the name of Jesus, and so hopefully he'll fix it. So what I didn't know was that that was the end result of something else that was going on. And so now you've got to begin, those of you who are contractors and understand, Brother Walt, you've got to begin to backtrack and see what triggered the leak that is visible. And so once you backtrack a little bit, I found that there were some rings around a toilet or something, O rings or V rings or C rings or U rings or something like that. But they bad, and so the toilet is leaking. But that's the initial stimuli, that's the initial trigger that has led to the pain that I'm feeling around the funeral home ceiling just getting done, and now I've got to go back and do it all over again. See the pain that we deal with in our lives, it has been a slow buildup to that point. You know, when you have the initial signs of a headache, there is something that caused that headache. When you begin to feel some pain in your leg, when you begin to feel some pain in your arm, there is something happening deep down in your biology that is the stimuli that is leading to that pain. It's up to you to take advantage of what's available to you to find the help to get that physical, have that physical pain taken care of, but there is something underneath it that's working. And the thing that we need to understand is that while that pain is representative of something, God is also in the background, working and needing and showing and trying to point something out to you that you need to take a look at this, because something is happening. And I need you to know, brothers and sisters, here in the Bethlehem Church, that on today, as a daughter and a son of God, there is some pain that is representative of your life that you've got to do some work to get to the bottom of it, to understand where it has come from, why it has come from, how it has happened. And you've got to ask in the name of Jesus that he help you backtrack so you can begin the process of identifying where it came from and, more importantly, what to do about it.
Yes.
If someone says, that is telling me who you are, but for me, I'm going to look to Jesus Christ, who in his claims have showed me time and time again that once we get to the realization of what the pain is, Jesus is there to give you the balm in Gilead to heal it on today. Keep going in that text. And then it says, if someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister, that person is a liar. Watch this. Pain is, it's a symptom of something that's deeper. There's a movie out right now called I'm Not Your Negro, and it captures the life of one of our great authors, James Baldwin. And he says this, I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense that once hate is gone, they'll be forced to deal with the pain. Let me read that one more time. I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense once the hate is gone, they'll be forced to deal with their pain. Brothers, let me help you with something. This is what I know about women, and then I'm going to help the women out with the men. Before you were in your relationship with your wife, she experienced other relationships. And there may have been some hurt in those relationships. There may have been some pain in those relationships. There may have been some trials in that relationship. And so if you've ever come across a desire to want to be with a woman and you recognize that there is this wall that is built up and that for some reason, some way, you can't get to her heart, it's taking you some time to get to her heart, it's because she is in a protectionist mode. Because the one thing that I know about someone who's been hurt, they can't continue to allow themselves to be in that vulnerable position. Am I right? Am I talking to you? Am I educating your brothers today? So you think that she is just as stubborn as she can be, just as mean as she can be. I don't know why she won't let me in. That's because, brother, she don't know if you're going to continue to be there like you keep saying you're going to be there, or if you're going to hurt her like it's been done in the past. A woman will allow you to begin to chip away at that wall slowly but surely as you begin to prove yourself, as you begin to do what you say you're going to do, as you begin to represent that you're the person that you say that you are, And more importantly, that you're going to protect her, you're going to keep her, you're going to watch out for her, and that you're going to help her to become the woman that God would have her to be. And until that point, brothers, because of the pain, there is a wall that's up. And so you just hang in there. It's a slow process. But when you get that wall down, you're going to discover she is the most dynamic and beautiful person that you could ever meet. And women, let me help you out. You ever meet a brother, he ain't got nothing to say? He got about, how you feeling? I'm good. How was your day? It was okay. What are we going to do for the weekend? Whatever you want to do. I mean, bro, can you give me a little bit more than just that? Because what has happened is that the brother at some point in his life has given more than that, and it didn't work out well for him. What are we going to do for the weekend? Oh, let's go through this. Let's try this. I didn't want to do that. Why don't you take me here? See, brothers not going to keep getting hurt based on their suggestions. They're going to allow themselves at some point, let you take the lead, and they're going to step back until they slowly can begin to see that the way that they are and the things that they suggest, that is not anything but in your best interest. And so when they begin to get a little bit of taste of success, then they'll step on out there a little bit further. Then they'll do a little bit more. Am I helping you out today, brothers? Yeah, I'm helping somebody out on today. Brother Steve said, thank you. Hopefully your wife is in here. She's hearing that, Brother Steve. Say more than a 7-word sentence, Brother Steve. It'll take you a whole lot further. When we are in pain, brothers and sisters, women and men, it's not only that you've got to build through this wall, but we don't have very much to say, but when you have been hurt by someone and when you are in pain, you gotta be careful, because you'll resort to wanting to numb that pain. So I'm be transparent. Y'all have heard this before. I suffer from alcoholism. I do. Because for me, alcohol is a way to numb some of my pain. It is a way. It was a way. It is a way for me that when I didn't want to face something, I would feel that if I could indulge myself and inebriate myself fully, then I wouldn't have to think about it anymore. Little did I know that once I sobered up, whatever I was trying to run away from was still there. And a lot of people do it a lot differently. I've known people who fall into kind of all kind of sexual promiscuity because when they face those troubles again, they're looking for something to fill a void, and they believe that going out there and just being with multiple people is a way just to go ahead and satisfy that void in their lives. I know sometimes those are things we shouldn't mention up here in church, but I'm just being real this morning. I know some folk who go twist it up, go get in line. So you go and numb the experience so you don't have to deal with the pain. What you'll begin to understand, and it's a process, is that way of numbing that thing, it doesn't heal the thing. It doesn't deal with the thing. It doesn't solve the thing. It doesn't make the thing any better. It's not until you say, Jesus, I'm trying everything that I can in this world, but it's just not satisfying me. It's not until you get on your knees and say, oh God, please, turn me away from this thing. Oh God, I need you, oh God. You can do this for me. When you get to that point and you recognize that it is Jesus Christ who can heal and deliver us through his strength that he'll get you out of that situation, then you'll begin to understand that there's no other way. I've tried everything, except there's no other way but Jesus. And then the third point, and I only got one or two more to go. You know, the preacher always says that, but we're going to take our time just a little bit this morning. This is the third thing that I see, y'all, that's beautiful. Text says this: for if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? Do you all understand that God sees you? And so do I. This is what I love about Christ. When you read his miracle stories, when you read his stories of transformation and healing stories, many times the text will begin this way: and Christ saw. So whoever the person was that was ailing, they never said to him, this is my trouble. Christ had the discernment to see before they even said anything. Do you all understand that the first language is seeing? So before you even say anything to me, I can see you. I can almost see that the way that you look is not the way you're supposed to look. The spirit that's coming up off of you is not the spirit that I'm accustomed to from you.
Right.
So before you even say anything, I can see it.
Yeah.
And do you understand too, Bethlehem? I need us to do some work. I need us to do some work. If we call ourselves Christians, if we call ourselves loving God and serving people and being a multicultural church, that means we've got to see the other in you. See, I need you to begin to do some work in this Bible. I need you to begin to understand that when I came here 13 years ago, I was wrapped up in that alcoholism. I was wrapped up in things of the world. I was wrapped up in stuff. But I didn't need you to judge me based on that. So I need us to do some work to recognize that just because someone else declares that they have a different sexual orientation, it's not your job to condemn them. It's your job to understand what this text says about that. And that at the end of the day, that person is a human being as well and needs to be loved. I need somebody to understand that when you see somebody with something on their head, wrapped up a turban, and looking different than you, and declaring themselves a follower of Islam, that they still a human being. I need you to understand that just because somebody worships on Saturday and calls that day the Sabbath, and they're going to the synagogue and the temple, that they still a human being. That just because we differ on religious points of view doesn't mean that we still don't serve the same God. I need y'all to do some, I need us to do some work, because the one thing that will happen is you're going to understand is when the prejudice that you have, recognizing that someone else looks different than you, the prejudice that is causing them pain.
Amen, that's right.
You are causing some pain. And so I need you to do some work. Because what's going to happen too, when you do the work, all of a sudden God's going to put somebody in your life so you can manifest that work. So you do the work to recognize that the Bible says that love the Lord thy God with all of thy heart, thy soul, thy strength, and thy mind. And while you're at it, love your neighbor too. You got to love the other. And then I need us to do this. Parents, when somebody in my family gets hurt, you know I get angry. Somebody in my family will fall down the steps and break a rib, and I get angry. I get angry because I don't want to see anybody in my house hurt. But it's a strange idiosyncrasy of mine that I get angry. They break an ankle. Why did you have to break your ankle? Now we got to go to the hospital. Now you're going to be in that cast for 6 weeks. Why did you do that? And my family's like, I tripped. What do you want me to do, kid? Just take me to the hospital. But what we want to do, if you're a father or a man, or you love somebody, a woman too, you just want to love your children. You want to love your husband. You don't want to see them hurt. But then I read an article. A woman by the name of Glennon Doyle Melton, who is an Oprah contributor, wrote this article, and she pointed it out this way. She said she had a failed marriage, she disappointed her kids, and she was doing a talk one day, and something came to her. She asked the people, she said, what are the characteristics that we're trying to build up in our children? And someone said, we want them to be kind, we want them to be wise, and we want them to be giving. And it hit her. In order to build up those kind of characteristics, do you do that by keeping them at home?
No.
Or do you do that by allowing them to go out and experience pain?
Right.
So you see what I mean? Yeah. We're so busy, those of us who love one another. We want to protect you from everything. I hear you got hurt. I don't want you to get hurt. Who hurt you? I'm going to go hurt them. No. As if the experience of the pain doesn't make you stronger. See, I just had a conversation with someone last night, and their son is in college right now. He ain't never worked a job in his life because all they did was take care of him all of their life. He ain't never been on a bus before. He don't know how to catch a bus from downtown to the suburb. He don't know nothing about a subway. And so now he's all the way across the country, and he got his first job, and he called home talking about, this is so hard. Yeah, that's because you kept him in the house. You didn't allow him to work because you were scared. You didn't allow him to date because you were scared. You didn't allow him to go out into the world because you were scared. You protected him so much that now he's just beginning at 21 to understand what to do. Brothers and sisters, protecting somebody doesn't allow them to understand who they are. Do you understand I'm a funeral director some 13 years later, but when I first got started, it was all hell. It was pain that I had to go through. The boss that I was with was more than a notion. The people didn't really care that I was coming in and being this person they had never seen before, didn't even have a license, and they just treated me bad, and I would work from 5 in the morning until 5 at night, and then going, it was just on and on and on and on, and I would say to myself, God, what is all this pain for? What we don't realize is that when we are going through and we are in the midst of that pain, that is doing nothing but building us with character and purpose. Because one thing you need to understand is that the pain that you're going through is leading you to the purpose for the person that you're supposed to be. Do you understand that Christ, that's right, do you understand that Christ said to his own father, Pastor, he said this to his own father, he said, take this cup from me. I know that I'm supposed to save these people, but in my divinity, I could be all things. God, let me get back to that. But in this humanity, I'm not doing well. This crown of thorns on my head, this piercing on my side. Now, oh God, take this thing away from me. But what he came to after he said that to his father was that if I don't move through this pain, I will not meet the purpose for which I was created. And so somebody needs to understand in here on today that you're going through some pain and you can't quite understand why you lost that job and you can't quite understand why you lost that baby and you can't quite understand why that you keep going through the hell you're going through. What you need to understand when you get on the other side of that and when you look back and see what it was all about, you'll see that that was purpose in your pain. And I'm wondering if there's anybody here right now who can understand that back in their life, as you look back over your life, you had to go through some things, and if it had not been for those things, you wouldn't be who you are, you wouldn't have what you have, you wouldn't be able to testify to what it is that it is to have the Lord come and bless you and lift you up out of something, you wouldn't be able to share with somebody else that just hang in there. God has you covered. When my father died, Deacon Ron Bradley sent me an email. He said, I hurt because you hurt. I never realized the comfort and the softness and the embrace that some words could mean as I was going through that. I hurt because you hurt. What that said was, bro, I know you're going through some stuff, but because you are going through that stuff, I'm going through the same stuff with you. And so, brothers and sisters, we've got to do some things with our pain. A past action is to forgive the pain. There are people up in here that have made some decisions in your life that you're still holding on to, that you can't let go of, and you're not fully who you are until you forgive that pain in the past. There are women who aborted babies. You got to forgive yourself for that. There are people who in a drunken stupor killed somebody. You got to forgive yourself for that. You ruined your family because of drug addiction. You got to forgive yourself for that. You cause friction on the job with your gossiping and with your messing with your furthering thing. You have to forgive yourself for those things. Otherwise, you can't be who you need to be. So that in the present day situation, when you realize some pain, you've got to be able to not only forgive some past pain, but in the present day, you have to be able to face the pain. Because here's what you do with facing the pain. When you have a loss in your life, and when you're dealing with something hard, you don't want to approach it. You walk right up to the door, and that pain is just about to manifest itself in terms of a breakdown or crying or tears or whatever it is that you do. But you don't allow yourself to go there because you say, I can't walk through that door. I don't want to experience those emotions. But you have to be able to face the pain. You have to be able to go right on through whatever it is that you deal with so that you can help yourself be strengthened by it. So if you've lost a husband, if you've lost a child, if you've lost a loved one, you got to walk right on up to the door, open the door, and go right through it. Because you're not walking alone. Christ is walking right with you. And then what happens is that once you face that pain and you forgive that pain, it's giving you a framework so that you can foresee pain. You see what I mean? Some of y'all know that at the cemetery, I release a dove. I've told this story before, but not in this way. So at the cemetery, right up here at White Marsh Cemetery, then I'm out your way. At White Marsh Cemetery, I have a routine in the manner in which I release this dove. I normally walk the family. I'll allow Pastor Quan to lead the family on over. He's reading scripture, and we arrive at the gravesite. Once everyone is settled around the grave, he begins with his committal process, ashes to ashes. He goes on with that language. And then in the meantime, while he's doing that, I have run back to the hearse, and I've grabbed the dove. And I have put it in my hand, and I've slowly captured it behind my cloak. And I make my way over to the gravesite, and then I move through my small little soliloquy. The reason why I do that, because you need to understand that out at the cemetery, there are predators awaiting the release of that dove because they're ready for lunch. And so I've got to keep that dove covered. I've got to keep that dove protected until it's time for her to fly. This one particular day, I didn't have the benefit of having someone with me, and so I was leading the procession over to the gravesite myself. And so one of my guys ran and got the dove and brought the whole cage. And the cage is open and it's visible. And so when I reached in and got the dove out, I pulled it out. And I began to move back through my soliloquy again. And then I released the dove, and I was moving on to the next day. And I looked over here and I saw someone, and they said, "Ooh." And then I kept on going because I said, "Oh, they must have stubbed their toe or something." And then I looked back and I looked and somebody else said, "Oh." I said, "Okay, that's two people that stubbed their toe. That's a coincidence." And I said, I looked over here and somebody said, and then I had a feeling. I had a feeling that because I had moved away from my regular routine, I had caused that dove great pain and great loss. Because that predator said, "Thank you very much. That's what you get for moving outside of your normal practice." But here's the end of the story. I talked to the dove whisperer. He's the guy who raises the dove the next week. And I said, "Brother, I'm going back to the same place, so I need you to leave me a dove." And so he left me a dove. And so I'm at the same cemetery. The same thing is happening. And so I say, "Oh my gosh. DJ is his name. I need you to let me know what I should do in this instance." He didn't pick up the phone. And so I didn't let the dove go that time because I was scared for the dove. I didn't want to experience that pain again. But then he called me back later on. He said, "Keith, I got your message last week when you said that you had released the dove and that the hawk had got it." He said, "Keith, I looked into my coop, and although you thought that the hawk had gotten that dove, I looked. And the dove, yeah, it lost a few feathers. His beak was a little crooked. He had a little blood on him. But he was in the coop." And he said, "Keith, you could have let that same dove go. Because now that you had let it go without your normal practice, but because you had let it go and it had an encounter with the enemy and beat the enemy, it was stronger, it was faster, and it was better, and it was wiser, and it had a framework of reference to be able to perceive that the next time you let me go, don't go straight, but..." All I'm trying to tell somebody on today is that in order to be able to foresee your pain, seen, you've got to know that you've got a framework of reference to be able to understand that everything that you've gone through doesn't do anything but help you be a little bit wiser, be a little bit stronger, and deal with the enemy like none other. I wonder if there's anybody in here who understands on today that in order to deal with pain, you might not be able to foresee it. You might not be able to understand when it's coming, but you've been through some things. And so you ought to know, that's not the path I need to go down. That's not the person I need to be dealing with. That's not the thing I need to be drinking again. That's not the place where I need to go. That's not the thing that I need to do. That's not the thing I need to say. Because while you might not be able to foresee what's coming, I will tell you this. There is a man named Jesus Christ who understands that while you may not know what's coming today, He holds tomorrow, and He knows what's coming. So you forgive yourself for all that pain you've been going through. You face that pain, and you foresee what's going to come. And every phase of that healing that you're going through, Christ the Jesus the Christ, is with you every step of the way on today. So do some work today, Bethlehem. Heal yourself. Be stronger. Be wiser and be better. Amen. In Jesus' name, we ask it all.
There may be someone this morning who's here, really needs to.